Hey guys, happy Movie Pass Thursday. Now, surge pricing is in the news. As we all know, Movie Pass announced a couple weeks ago that they would be rolling out surge pricing in July. And sure enough, it started to pop up for a lot of users where once you load up the Movie Pass app, you're going to see a little lightning bolt thing, which basically is like a charge. And that's their way of saying it's a surge, I guess, saying that they're going to charge you a little extra, somewhere between $2 to $4, depending on the movie you want to see. If you want to see a movie that's like on opening weekend or during a night where there's a lot of people supposedly at the activity of the theater, they're going to institute what they call surge pricing. And I guess at this point, first of all, there are going to be some initial hiccups. And more importantly, nobody likes to pay more than the $9.95 that they were paying. So right away, surge pricing itself isn't something that some people were saying, oh, okay, cool. Obviously, there's no customer that's going to like it unless there's someone that's saying, oh, this is what's going to keep Movie Pass in business for another two more months than it would have been otherwise. Yay. But beyond that, it's obviously not a good thing when a company's charging you more. And by surge pricing, the worst thing about it is that it's actually creating – it's blurring the value proposition of MoviePass, since you really don't know how much you're going to pay. And right now, there's still anecdotal evidence of someone coming in and saying they were going to come see a 9:30 movie, and that had the surge pricing thing, but the 10 o'clock movie didn't. And so there's all these weird dynamics of exactly what is being tagged, and people are some seeing surge-priced movies that they go in and the theater's empty, and they're wondering, really? But let's backtrack a little bit on this to talk about the history of demand-based pricing. Now, you may not realize it, but a lot of things, MoviePass isn't really breaking new ground here. There are a lot of companies that depend on demand-based pricing. A lot of sports venues, if you have a local pro football, basketball, baseball, hockey team in your town, there's a good chance that when you're buying tickets, some games are going to cost more than others. A lot of, and I'm not talking about the scalpers that are just a normal like post-market, second market, third market demand rather. I'm talking about actually the actual companies, the actual teams selling tickets from their stadiums. They will charge more based on different games. You actually have theme parks. The leading theme parks do have now, as a few years ago, they have peak value and medium, like regular season pricing for one-day tickets. So there are people out, and yes, even movie theaters, if we think about it, they do have demand-based pricing. That's what matinees are about, the cheaper matinees, the Tuesday promotions that many theaters have, the fact that movies cost more at night than they do earlier in the day. All these things come into factor that demand-based pricing is just a reality of life. But we get to the fact that surge-based pricing and demand-based pricing, as it's been formally known, is something that is charged by the end service. The person, so this is stadium charging the demand pricing. It's the movie theater charging more. Surge pricing, the term, became popular when Uber started doing it a couple years ago. Uber, the ride-sharing service, started saying, hey, you know what? It's getting hard to find drivers on New Year's Eve or certain holidays or certain peak periods when there's a lot of people that want to go from place to place. So they introduced surge pricing. So, and as you can imagine, you're on Uber or Lyft or whatever, and you're looking for a ride, and then it'll tell you surge pricing is in effect. So you're going to pay more than you normally would because that's the market conditions. It's supply and demand. In that case, the money goes to the driver who's willing to go out there and be out there on the 4th of July or during the New York City, during Broadway pre-dinner traffic when people are trying to get to and from the theaters. All these things that are happening are money that goes directly to the theater. Obviously, the theater that charges more for the premium screening than the matinee, they are making the difference in the money themselves. The thing about surge pricing as far as it goes to MoviePass is that it's not the theater imposing this charge. It's not the movie theater that's saying, oh, you're charging $3.66. I'm going to come back to me with that MoviePass. No, MoviePass is just pocketing it, which is just their way of subsidizing just the fact of doing business. MoviePass knows in its current model, it can't make money on $9.95 a month with people seeing more than one or two movies a month. That's financially, mathematically a given. A lot of things have to change in the model for them to be able to make a profit the way the model is now. And a lot of it means money coming in from channels that are just not happening right now, and they're not likely to happen anytime soon. So with the whole MoviePass thing, the money that they're being charged surge pricing is going to MoviePass. So right away, that has to be rubbing a lot of people the wrong way. But let's think two steps ahead of this. I'm going to tell you about a little DVD rental company. And they did something, you know, movie studios, like now, did not like what was happening. And again, it's not movie theaters, movie studios. They didn't like that these DVD rental companies were basically renting products either from like a dollar from kiosk or by mail with unlimited monthly plans. And they did not like because it devalued the product. They weren't selling enough new DVDs anymore when these movies came on sale because of the existence of these other services. And it's all starting to sound pretty familiar to you. Let me tell you what Netflix, yes, I'm talking about Netflix, the DVD-based Netflix, not the streaming one that most of us enjoy now, and Redbox, which is still in business. What they did is that they came to terms with the studios. And Netflix did it first. They went, I believe Time Warner was the first studio that they went to, and they said, all right, okay, what if we don't make this movie available to our DVD Netflix subscribers until 28 days after it's already out on sale? So if someone really wanted to buy the movie, they could buy the movie, and that would be it. And the studio said, hey, this works for us. In fact, we'll sell it to you at a lower price, and we'll give you as many copies as you need of the movie as long as you hold us to this 4-week window, this 28-day window, where no one could rent this movie from your site. So if they really wanted to see it, they would go out and legitimately either purchase it or go through other channels to see the movie rather than through a Netflix. That's just they just buy the movie once and just keep renting it out over and over again. Ditto with Redbox. And Netflix said yes. And at the time, everyone thought like, oh, this is the end of Netflix. They are caving into what the DVD, to what the movie studios want. Hollywood wants this, so they're going to pay, basically make their service less of what it is for that. So, but we all know how the story ends. Netflix, eventually their DVD subscribers, they peaked at 15 million back around 2010. And then as DVD usage itself wore down, so did the sound. There's about just 3-4 million DVD Netflix subscribers now. The main service, the one with 130, 140 million subscribers, is the streaming global service. But they still do the DVD stuff. So, and just in case you're checking, that restriction is still in place. There's a lot of movies you'll notice on the Netflix DVD queue that you have to wait 4 weeks after they come out before you can actually receive a copy of it. And what's important here is that this was the concession that made the movie studios say, okay, we can play with Netflix. And in a sense, I can almost see this happening in MoviePass. Not so much surge pricing, because surge pricing, what it's doing is trying to get people off the opening weekends and off the prime time slots. But at the end of the day, MoviePass is going to do this whenever they want. People are going to be frustrated if it's not told well ahead of time what they're getting into. Because the last thing you want, you're going to go see a movie and they say, oh, I got to shell another $3-4 to see this movie. It's a great deal if you didn't have MoviePass. You'd pay $3 or $4 for any movie. It would be awesome. But if you have to pay this in addition to it, eventually you get to the point where your pricing is pricing yourself within the AMC Stubs, A-List, Premiere, and other clubs that are bound to come out, where have fixed prices and not these variable pricing. So, but the important thing here about what happened with Netflix and how it should apply here to MoviePass, and again, this video is coming out. It's mid-July, and we'll know in a couple months if I was right or wrong, is the next step I think that MoviePass will take, and I don't think it's the right step, but I think it's the inevitable step to make the movie theater owners happy, is eventually MoviePass is going to do the same thing. They're going to say, all right, you know, we're going to let you use this, but, and again, you can't do 28 days, because in 28 days, some movies are completely off the grid. They're not even showing a lot of these 28 days later. But it would not surprise me if MoviePass says, all right, the first step could be that you can't watch a new premiere within a week of it coming out, or maybe even 2 weeks at the most. But what this would do is just do a couple things, because for the movie theater industry, it's important to know that obviously they make more of the money. Their per screen average is always higher when a movie first opens for the first weekend, and then it just declines every weekend after that. Once in a while, you'll have a movie like, let's say, like a My Big Fat Greek Wedding or some other kind of movie that just starts slow and just builds up gradual, and momentum picks up. But for the most part, a movie starts big and then just diminishes. So the theater's already pulling the screens that are showing it, fewer screens. But there's a case where they have to find a way to fill these empty seats, and that's where MoviePass would come in. In the case where if MoviePass says, "All right, we're not going to sell people to let people go see, let's say Jurassic World the first 2 weeks that it's open." The movie theaters owners would say, hey, you know what? That's not too bad. I can live with that. And that's when they would start doing the concessions. Because for starters, how the movie theater works. I mean, again, you think, oh, movie theaters are making a lot of money. No, I mean, the movie companies make the movies for the first couple of weeks. They make the lion's share of the revenue. The reason why you have a lot of these dollar cinemas, if they still exist around where you are, or maybe $2 cinemas, whatever they're up to, on the fringes, is that they show movies that are a couple weeks, even a couple months old, before they hit the next release window, which is the DVD and the home release, home theater release. And in that time, the movie theaters are willing to take a much smaller percentage of the actual revenue box office. So that first weekend, the box office, about 90% in some cases, goes right back to the movies, movie makers. So the movie, the theater owner is not making that money. So what's happening in this particular case, by delaying the viewing window of when you can see a movie, you can't see it the week it comes out or the 2 weeks, you can do it on your own dime. And then you can see it a second time on your MoviePass card because you paid for it the first time. But by doing this, they set the stage for letting, hey, theater owner, we're no longer trying to fill up seats that you could have sold to people that would be paying full price and not devaluing the product. We're actually putting out a product that makes repeat viewings or later viewings in a film's life cycle more accessible, to give you ways to get more people into the seats. And that would naturally solve a lot of problems for the movie theater industry, which, despite the recent hiccup, a spike in interest, largely fueled by MoviePass, let's be fair, it's a declining business. By doing that, they would say, okay, we can actually have people funnel them out a little further out. And if they can get come in and see this movie 2 or 3, 4 weeks from now, it's not as bad as if they're coming in and basically filling up theater and taking up seats of a sold-out movie that would go on to be sold out for other people. So I see this happening. Surge pricing is not cool. Sorry, not cool, in the fact that we're paying more for certain screenings, and most of us will be able to avoid it if we know how, or if we can just say, all right, we're not going to see it this time, we'll see it tomorrow, or see it the next day, or after that, whenever it's available. But it's going to be a very unpleasant thing for a lot of people. But I think once MoviePass gets to the point of the next inevitable step, and I know this is not fun for people because you see all these commercials, this movie's coming now, and there's spoilers out there, you have to see this movie now. No one wants to see Marvel, Infinity War, 2 weeks after it comes out, when everyone's talking about it that opening weekend. But that's the inevitable future of MoviePass, where if they want to please the movie theater owners to the point where they can get cheaper tickets than what's the face value on the ticket, and that is the reason why MoviePass will never make a profit because they're paying retail price for most tickets. Once that happens, then they can start getting concessions. And then you can get to the point where there'll be different MoviePass tiers, where it'll be $40 or $50 a month for any screening, even premiere screenings, or the $9.95, where you have to wait 2 weeks for a movie to come out with the surge pricing and all these things. Again, I mean, I'm just reading the tea leaves here. I don't have any inside information, but I think it's inevitable that it follows this route, that if MoviePass is losing money, and we know they are, and if they need to make money, which we know they do, and they're going down this path where they're making things harder for you to get tickets, like no repeat viewings, no anything else, eventually now no surge price, now surge pricing, eventually it will get to the point where they will have to say you can't see a movie the week it comes out. At the very least, the weekend, and maybe it'll stretch from the opening weekend to the opening 2 weekends, or maybe only weekday pass. We see this happen all the time. Talking about theme parks earlier, Disney, they have different passes. They have one pass that you basically can go whenever you want, and they have some where they blacked out certain periods of the calendar year where you can't use this pass. It's what happens. It's inevitable, and I think it's going to be something that no one's going to look forward to. But I think once we get to that point where there's enough measures in place where movie theaters start giving concessions to MoviePass, or MoviePass actually puts out financial statements that said that they're at least close to profitability, that's when the investors will come back in. That's when the financing will come back in, and that's when you will be able to exhale and say, "This is the MoviePass plan that I think will stick around for a few months, possibly even a few years." So yes, changes are not good in the MoviePass world because all the changes have been working against us subscribers. But at the end of the day, there will finally come that one move that will put MoviePass in the point where they will be able to stay sustainably in business. And I think it will be that move to delaying their access to a new release under the current plan, and then they'll roll out higher price plans. And that's how I call it. And if I'm wrong, in a few months from now, you can come back on the video, comment, and say, "Dude, MoviePass, you totally blew it." But for now, that's my call. And this is your MoviePass Thursday update on surge pricing, the good, the bad, and definitely the ugly, and the inevitable future of MoviePass. See you soon.